Les plus fabuleux trésors du monde, celui de Thompson, un flibustier anglais qui aurait caché au cœur de cette île un magot évalué à 600 millions de dollars. La chasse est ouverte, l'aventure aussi.
Des histoires qui circulent de bouche à oreille, des contes pour enfants où l'on parle de galions, de pirates, de batailles et de trésors. Cette île, au loin dans la brume, est entrée dans l'histoire. L'île des Cocos, minuscule rocher noyé dans les vagues du Pacifique, îlot perdu au large du Costa Rica. Ici, chaque colline, chaque lagon a été témoin des plus grands épisodes de la piraterie. Cette île n'est qu'un gigantesque coffre-fort où reposent plus de 1000 millions de dollars d'or, d'argent et de pierres précieuses déposés, 43 trésors enfouis sous l'épaisse végétation de l'île sans que jamais personne ne découvre l'Eldorado. Et pourtant ici repose l'un des plus grands trésors de tous les temps, celui de Lima, volé par le capitaine Thompson en 1820. A été constitué, son but, fouiller les grottes inaccessibles de l'île.
Glad you made it.
Yeah.
Where is your girlfriend?
I don't know.
We missed the girl. We must go and find a girl, huh?
Yeah.
Very good.
¿Quieres venir a tomar una cerveza?
Okay, con mucho gusto.
No problem.
Vamos y buscamos a muchacha.
Okay.
Okay.
Vamos.
Okay.
Pour mettre en place l'organisation de cette expédition, pour qu'au moment où l'équipe arrive, toute la logistique soit en place, notamment l'achat des vivres, détail essentiel pour des Français, même baroudeurs. Il y a des trésors partout dans le monde, le plus important étant, d'après le Club international des chasseurs de trésors, celui des Incas au Pérou. L'île des Cocos, but de notre expédition, est le second par son importance de tous les trésors terrestres. Il ne s'agit pas d'un mythe. Les nombreux documents et les plans anciens s'y rapportant en témoignent. C'est aussi pour un chasseur de trésors digne de ce nom, un point de passage obligé dans sa quête.
And the story of Cocos Island? It's a story of treasure. We were able to catalog four buried treasures on Cocos Island. Four big treasures? Yes, four big treasures, not counting various small ones. The most important one is from Lima, Peru, and dates from 1821, the year... Are there any other buried treasures on Cocos Island? Yes, there are. One of the most famous is supposedly buried by Benito Bonito, otherwise known as Bonito of the Bloody Sword. This gentleman was a defrocked priest who called himself Don Pedro Benitez. He was Portuguese, a sailor turned pirate. He captured an English boat named Lightning, which he read. This book was published during the last century. It contains the confession of Bonito Benito's pirates, who were captured and condemned to death by hanging. In this book, each pirate indicates the location of his buried treasure.
Captain Thompson put to sea in the sailing ship Mary Dear. The English sailors of the Mary Dear were about as honest as any merchant seaman, and it wasn't long before the $60 million of treasure in their ship's hold cast its spell upon them. A day and a half into their voyage, the crew mutinied. Sailed for Cocos Island, where the crew insisted that the treasure be divided. Nine boatloads of treasure were rowed ashore, where each sailor lugged his loot into the jungle to hide. The Mary Dear left Cocos and was captured several days later. Costa Rican historian and journalist Christopher Weston is the preeminent expert on Cocos Island.
To the island in the 1880s, he had been given a map by a dying seaman aboard the ship he was serving on. And it indicated a treasure that had been hidden on the island by Benito Bonito. So Gisler found the island. He was able to get contracts with the Costa Rican government. He even brought 18 German families to colonize the island. And he spent over 20 years in total looking for the treasure. He was excavating all over the place. He built some huge tunnels, which you can still see on the island in certain sections, especially in Wafer Bay. Some of these tunnels go in about 50 meters. And he spent very terrible days there, tremendous hardships. And in the end, he found nothing. He left the island in 1906. And finally, he died in New York in 1935. At about that time, another map came to light, which was the famous Forbes map. which was used by one Jimmy Forbes the Fourth, who said he was the great grandson of James Alexander Forbes the First, who said he was the mate of the Mary Dear, and who with William Thompson had buried treasure on Cocos Island. Who knows? But the thing is that Forbes the Fourth did come to the island. He came on 7 or 8 expeditions, and he spent tremendous amount of money. He brought in huge machinery. He built huge caissons on the beach in Chatham Bay, which you can still see there. The purpose of this was for the tide not to come into the excavations that he was building there. And he found nothing. He spent hundreds of thousands of dollars, and he also left frustrated. As a matter of fact, on his last expedition in 1963, much trouble. So here it is, and I added it to a collection of over 100 maps that I have on treasure on Cocos Island, which I believe mostly are what I call authentic fakes. But I do have 2 or 3 maps which I think are good, and possibly, in one of the sites that are indicated there, treasure could be found. I think treasure will be found on Cocos Island. There's no doubt about this. Treasure is there. It will be found either by accident or by chance or because somebody really has the good luck to be digging in the right place at the right time, and he's going to make it. So meanwhile, what we have to do is to enjoy the other treasure of Cocos Island, which is the one you and I know, and all the divers that are coming there today, which is the wonderful submarine world of Cocos Island.
...of Honduras, and are aware of the difficult conditions found on such expeditions. Each person brings a particular skill and has been assigned a role in the expedition. Divers, speleologists, geologists, electronics engineers, and a doctor.
Ici, nous faisons la jonction. La jonction à peu près comme ça, si vous laissez un peu de place.
C'est au-dessus, ouais. Ça, c'est la même.
Mais un peu, ça monte un peu sur le
côté. On fait les Amériques, là.
Comme ça. Débrouille-toi à ce que ce soit la saison.
Ouais, c'est pas. Voilà.
Comme ça. Comme ça, Nato. Voilà.
So, Christopher Weston went there with his son last week to investigate. They spent most of their efforts studying Wafer Bay near Rio Genio, an area which, in their opinion, could be very interesting. Regarding Iglesias Bay, I think that the grotto that Robert Beniez discovered is either this one or that one.
Quant à la baie Iglesias, la grotte de Verne.
At the moment, the best place to land is here, to the left of the cataract, because the rivers are dry now, and everywhere else we'll find ourselves up against a 5-meter-high rock wall. But that could serve as protection? Isn't this a good place to land? No, it's not safe here now. There's a small beach just a little further where we can try and land.
Non, ici c'est pas bon maintenant. Alors on débarque ici, il y a une toute petite plage de quelques mètres pour débarquer.
This is it. The departure time has finally come. Team leaves Richard Chatham's ranch, which they had used as a stopover. The Manutea should have reached Punta Reñas, the embarkation point for Cocos, by now. But the radio is totally silent. There is no news of the ship. A storm has been forecast than scheduled. But the main thing for everybody is finally to be able to leave. It projects a remarkable impression of power and grace. The dream is finally becoming reality as our adventurers catch sight of the proud 36-yard-long schooner that may soon concretize their hopes. Tons of food provisions and equipment have been loaded into the Manutea's hold. A sort of excitement gradually takes hold of the team as they step up their efforts to get the ship to weigh anchor as soon as possible. The land and underwater metal detectors are taken apart and camouflaged in the bags of food to escape the curiosity of onlookers. The truth is that this type of equipment is forbidden on Cocos Island.
Paris.
Enable them to move forward a bit.
quand les mecs l'ouvrent.
In the hold, Ernest, with the help of Daniel, the doc, is working away at getting the diving compressor into shape. Meanwhile, above deck people get ready to restore the old Zodiac, somewhat worn by time, to its old glory. So they talk. They talk about the 500 or so expeditions which have set out for this island since the mid-19th century, most of them in the strictest illegality. Some of them had very few means at their disposal. Others, considerable means. Some were led by notorious ciphers, others by prestigious figures like Sir Michael Campbell, the world champion who piloted the fastest racing car on Great Salt Lake and was knighted by the Queen of England. Or President Franklin Roosevelt, who spent some time here in 1937. Or James Alexander Forbes, the American millionaire, who deployed impressive financial and technical means on four different occasions. Third day at sea. The wind rises, and with it, the energies of our crew. One of us gets busy on deck to get ready to raise the sails that will welcome our long-awaited guest, the wind.
If I take a little more.
This time, there it is. The silhouette of Cocos Island emerges in the distance. Everybody rushes to the front of the Manutea to get a good look at it. So, as the day rises, Cocos Island appears to the team, more grandiose and impressive than ever. Its deep green color contrasts surprisingly with the blue of the Pacific Ocean around it, and obviously justifies its name, the Emerald of the Pacific. The team members quickly realize the enormous difference between the plans which they have carefully pieced together in the many earlier briefings and reality. The impressive green block has been put there like a wall, an unsurmountable and impenetrable obstacle. The first formality awaiting the team is to send scouts who will meet the three guards stationed on the island and present the team's passports. Next is to wait for the scouts' return. Now sets off for the first landing on the island. Cocos Island is small, but its area is still 241 square kilometers, with a length of 7.6 kilometers and a width of 4.4 kilometers. It actually seems much bigger when one is faced with it. Its wet tropical climate, it rains 10 times as much there as in Paris, nourishes a very dense vegetation which literally covers it, with not the slightest clearing or place where a camp of a decent size could be set up. The topography of the island is very uneven. The Sierra Iglesias, an extinct volcano over 600 meters high, towers over the undulations. Hundreds of little streams run down its sides, earning the island its reputation of an oasis in the middle of the Pacific Ocean. March along the streams, 350 steps. then shift to north-northeast, 850 yards. At the limit of shade and sun, a cave marked with a cross, there is the treasure. This is the kind of enigmatic text which many a treasure hunter took with him as he set off for adventure in Cocos Island. Our team is now looking for a cave where some human remains were found some 20 years ago. But once again, the terrain proves punishing for our team.
Oula.
Christopher was present when this famous grotto was discovered, and he told me it was an ideal place to hide treasure because it overhangs the sea by 40 to 50 meters. There's no need to go any higher. Yes, the only obvious way to locate any holes is by climbing a bit to 30 or 40 meters above water level. Here, I once climbed under one of the rios from below, underneath the waterfall. Total darkness. But we can't climb here because of the overhang. Instead, by roping down, we can explore them one by one. Okay? Let's go while we're hot, because afterwards I'll get scared. Part of the team returns to the boat to report the results of the day's search, while the other sets off for the Quebrada Liebre stream, which reportedly contains many traces of the passage of prior expeditions, and who knows, of the pirates themselves. Everyone hopes to find the clue that might lead to the path to one of the fabulous treasures of the island.
C'est Winship, Winship, Boston, chose votre Massachusetts, 1817, c'est vieux, hein?
And it would be imprudent to continue deeper into the darkness along the streams. The divers get ready for exploration in the Bay of Chatham. Their goal is to find a few pieces of the Lima treasure. The truth is that when this famous treasure was brought ashore by Captain Thompson in 1821, the launch of the 11th trip necessary to unload such a large quantity of gold overturned only a dozen yards from the beach. The golden object sank rather deeply into the sandy bottom, and with the means available at the time, it proved impossible to find them. Using their underwater detectors, the divers, led by Renaud, the chief diver, hope that luck and their equipment will enable them to locate the objects. But the conditions for underwater detection prove very difficult. The metal detectors are disturbed by the high mineral content of the seabed in Chatham Bay. The chances of finding anything at all seem more and more remote. But our divers quickly discover another treasure, as marvelous as the Lima treasure, the fawn. The sea bottom is full of life, fish, skates, all sorts of species of sharks swim alongside each other in the mating period.
No individual upon whom to focus. Each fish looks just like the next one, and this is what keeps them alive. Fish congregate because it is safer. Together they confuse their enemies. Alone they are easy prey. White-tipped sharks are ubiquitous here. Frequently overlooked, the couch potatoes of the shark family do spend a lot of time just lying around. At Cocos, their sheer numbers diminish their majesty, and divers tend to ignore them completely. But white-tipped sharks are not to be underestimated. They are extremely efficient hunters. White tips constantly patrol the reef and are always the first to locate a tasty morsel. In this case, an octopus is the unfortunate victim. Pity the poor octopus. Placid and intelligent, it depends on disguise to blend in with its surroundings. But once its cover is blown, it becomes fair game. Its meager defenses exhausted, it must flee. Every ecological niche at Cocos is filled by organisms specialized for the task. Here a school of parrotfish rides the surface surge, feeding on algae stirred up by the relentless waves. Locating and excavating buried crustaceans. Cocos Island is home to many, many eels of several species. Often seen free swimming, these sleek predators are not shy. They boldly defend their domain against all comers, no matter how large. because at the top of the food pyramid, those who have no natural enemies are limited only by their food supply. Hammerhead sharks live at Cocos in schools numbering in the hundreds. The vastness of the food pyramid which sustains them is virtually unimaginable. Unfortunately, even prime predators have an enemy. The incredible concentration of sharks and other fish at Cocos has not escaped the attention of fishermen. Although Costa Rica has recently taken bold and effective action to curb illegal fishing at Cocos, hammerheads and silky sharks have, in the past, been hunted for their fins, which are considered an aphrodisiac in Asia. The real impact of humanity's rapacious greed is seldom seen, out of sight, out of mind. But every once in a while, a graphic example comes along, compelling evidence that is difficult to ignore. This manta ray has somehow snagged a fishing line 50 feet long. During the months that she has dragged it through the ocean, inches through her forehead. When another diver arrived to help, Avi handed him the camera so he could work with both hands.
In the evening, it would be foolhardy to venture into their territory. But for the time being, they are not a real threat for our divers. In the morning, the team makes its way to the camp of the guards with whom Albert has gone off in the night to hunt for wild pigs.
Pour trajet les obus, j'ai rencontré les gardes de l'île. Le réalisateur se prête de bonne grâce à une séance de tir avec l'arme d'un des gardes. Détail qui a son importance pour lier amitié avec des militaires. C'est impénétrable. Le seul moyen est d'aborder par la baie Iglesias, bien qu'elle soit réputée dangereuse. En effet, ce versant de l'île...
You're going to see some landing, have to limit the baggage. Christ. I saw the grotto with the treasure. There were 2 or 3 meters of loose earth. The sea is beginning to eat away at it. But there were still 2 or 3 narrow passageways to get through with that heavy surf. You pass through it and it extends over 10 to 20 meters. And there you go through so fast, you don't know where you are. There's little cove that you can reach by swimming. It's difficult to get there without getting all the equipment wet, especially the camera. The problem is swimming up to it.
Par contre, après, pour aller filmer l'île, on va pouvoir enjamber, faire un petit rappel, descendre toutes les affaires au sec. Le problème, c'est pour aborder. À mon avis, c'est inabordable. De toute façon, c'est inabordable. On s'aborde à la nage.
Ernest returns to the area in the hope of finding a breach that would allow access to the famous cave without too much damage.
L'aventure survenue il y a 27 ans à Robert Verne. Cherchant à rejoindre la grotte au trésor, son Zodiac fut retourné par une de ces énormes vagues et ses deux compagnons périrent noyés et dévorés par les requins. Et pourtant, il faut y aller.
First, we'll try to reach the cave by sea, the other by land. The second approach will require many hours on foot, in a withering heat, along the streams, as usual, as well as along the shore, and by cutting...
The island is also home to introduced goats and deer, while pigs brought to the island 2 centuries ago are the only remaining pure representatives of their race. Cocos is protected now as a cornerstone of the Costa Rican National Park System. The only human residents of the island are Park Service rangers.
The first team, once all its members have landed,
now sets off confidently towards the cave, so well defended by nature.
Elle est là-haut, là-dessous.
Mini crickets.
Crickets, yes. Yes. Et allez, maintenant. Sans mettre un double rappel, juste pour faire une... Petit allumeau, hein.
The team quickly comes upon a whole network of small caves. Exploration is slow. The galleries are often narrow and their ceiling low. Some of them seem to have been dug by human hands. I suggest that we attack the well at the back, the one with two branches. It's accessible from the outside, but it's deep, so we'll need a rope.
The blow dryer.
Exploration is painstaking, and the equipment is beginning to suffer from the surrounding humidity.
Okay. Alessio, take top.
Okay.
There, it's squeaking, huh? An old knife sheath made of iron. An old blade. Keep going. It's ringing. And what's that? It's a coin.
Yes,
William, we found a coin.
A piece of yellow.
Ouais. Gold.
Gold.
How big is it?
Sorry?
I don't see. Is it big? No. Oui. Oui, oui.
It's gold. Yes, it's gold.
How many? Une. Attends. On gratte. Let's see. Il y en a d'autres. La fortune.
Wait. Keep scraping. There's another one. Fortune. Here's another one.
Regarde.
Look.
Can I see?
I can't read it. William, I see 1700. Then I can't read anymore.
That's good.
Jackie, catch.
Yeah. Deux. Two.
Yes, they're beautiful.
For a moment, it seems as if we are on the track of a major discovery. But after the two items, no others are found. They were probably part of a... We're using rather simple equipment because it's not worthwhile bringing sophisticated equipment here.
First of all, in these atmospheric conditions, everything would soon be damaged. And second, it's a better bet to count on head size and emitted power, because we're looking big and deep.
Et sur la puissance émise, puisqu'on cherche gros et profond.
Also, we know from scientific reports that geologically it's full of magnetite and megamite. In other words, magnetic substances derived from iron, which are aligned with a certain direction in the ground, and aluminum oxides, which are aligned in the opposite direction. It's better to use equipment which can pass through all of that and give a signal only when there's something worth signaling.
Autant les compenser par des appareils qui traversent tout ça et qui ne causent que réellement quand il y a une masse.
Vous y êtes tous là ?
Ouais. Je ne sais pas si on y est tous.
Ils sont trop fous, ils font des conneries.
C'est vachement féroce, hein ?
C'est pour les Américains, j'ai peur.
Ok.
Ok.
We
did a good job. We're not going to unearth this treasure for the benefit of future generations. Some team members take a short break from prospecting to solemnly engrave a symbol or their name on the rocks of Chatham Bay, hoping to leave an indelible mark. By chance, Ernest finds the remains of the digs undertaken by Forbes, the billionaire, a cylindrical metal vat buried by the tide. Here we are inside Forbes' digs. We have to ask ourselves how he managed to bring in these large pieces of iron with the intention of breaking in. He must have really believed in it. There's still some depth with respect to the beach. 2 meters. Ah, these old fellows knew what they were doing.
Ah, ils étaient vaillants, les grands-pères.
Cocos Island owes its name to the large number of coconut trees which the pirates brought there, in the hope that their fruit would supply them with a major additional source of food on their next stop. Richard then symbolically plants 4 coconut trees to their memory in the bay that bears his name, Chatham. The team returns to the Manutea. All of them seem still under the spell of their latest emotions. Nevertheless, it is with mixed feelings of joy and nostalgia which predominates.
Tu as loupé l'image de ta vie, Albert me tenant dans ses bras, c'était comme pas une fille la tenue dans ses bras. Damn. Ouais,
hein. With the ropes hanging over a little bit.
Like this, you know, I'm 6 feet tall, right? And down like this, there's a little detector, like an old detector somebody left down there.
People already start recounting these great moments, still so recent in the past tense.
Up under there, but it's about this high, just carved out of the rock. I don't know how much of it is natural. Some of it is excavated.
So you saw the grotto, was it dry inside? Humidity is 100%, but when you're inside, it's dry. There's no running water inside. Without a doubt, there are three usable meters. Diggable, I mean, which could be used to hide treasure. What you mean to say is the bird has flown?
The bird is gone, perhaps. Happy Amateur.
Bon les gars, là vous savez pas que c'est bon.
Il y a toutes les photos là.
Just a pleasant memory. Shall we head back? The Emerald of the Pacific has still not yielded its secret, but everyone nurtures the hope deep down that he will come back one day. For as the old Costa Rican saying goes, when you have been to Cocos Island, you always come back. Always. This time, Albert did not engrave his name in Cocos, because it already was on a rock there. The date inscribed under it is 1895. Perhaps an ancestor of his was already involved in treasure hunting. In any case, he will not give up and is already preparing another expedition, one last and decisive expedition. For, as he often repeats to his listeners when speaking of the treasure hunters, their adventures, just as those of the pirates who caused them, deserve to enter into the legend.